Welcome to Seattle Sports Union, the best in local Seattle sports coverage. I'm Abraham DeWeese, and with me is Matt Page, and we're going to talk a little bit of baseball today. How about a lot of baseball? It started.
It's opening day.
It started, Matt. Yes, you'd never know because there's only a couple games on rather than a full day of coverage. But here at Seattle Sports Union, we have listed our projections for where each of the division winners are going to place in the playoffs and who's going to win the World Series. And let's dig right into it. We're going to go through the projections from various writers on the team, and you can check these projections out on an article you're going to write.
Yes, it should be up on our site later tonight. You'll be able to see not only everyone else's predictions, but you know the actual expert baseball editor himself will actually have his prediction up there as well.
All right, great.
We broke it down by every division, the wild card slots, and how many wins everyone thought everyone was going to do, along with the postseason, the divisions and the championship series and the World Series.
Okay, great. Let's go through some of these picks. Let me list off what Aaron Kemp, one of our writers, has listed and get your feedback on this.
All right.
So he has Kansas City going back to the playoffs in the American League, taking on the Astros, and you'll also see Toronto and Seattle in the American League Divisional Series.
Okay.
Any ideas? Do you like these picks? Are some pie in the sky, or are they pretty generically basic?
They're pretty basic. I mean, you know, one thing you're going to notice is, yeah, we're not hometown biased at all or anything.
You're going to see a lot of Mariners in these picks.
You might see some Mariners in these picks. I don't think it's unreasonable to pick the Mariners in one of the wild card slots, more likely the second one.
Excellent. Do you have any thoughts on KC winning that American League Central?
I think it's very possible they can pull that off again. I don't think they're going to repeat and go all the way again, but it is kind of a weak division.
I was about to ask you, it's not very strong, is it? I don't really like the Indians. I don't like the Tigers. It's down to the Twinkies and the
White Sox?
I'm not a big fan of the White Sox either. I think it's down to the Twins and the Royals, but I don't even think the Royals are that great either.
Well, I think the White Sox are you're underestimating the White Sox.
Am I underestimating the White Sox?
And second of all, you're also underestimating the pitching in Cleveland. The pitching in Cleveland is really, really top notch.
No, I know. You have Kluber.
Well, yeah, but I mean, when you have Trevor Bauer and you're sending him to the bullpen.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, there's some wealth of pitching there.
I don't know. For some reason, the Twins seem to do it every year, but Kansas City's not a bad pick. You're right. And the Astros probably is going to win that American League West, isn't it? Aren't they?
The Astros will definitely win. I'm gonna call it right now. They're doing it. It's gonna happen. They have the best pitching. They have the best offense. They have the youth to do it. They have the depth to do it. It's all around. They have the farm system to trade for more pieces at the deadline if they need to. They're poised.
Excellent. So Aaron has also in the National League Divisional Series the Cubs and the Cardinals, the Nationals and the Giants.
None of those are really surprising either. The Nationals are a fan favorite pick. They really, I mean, they've got the pitching, they've got the offense, and with Bryce Harper leading them.
Excellent.
Very, very likely they'll go.
Aaron has Toronto and the Royals facing off in the American League Championship Series with Toronto going to the World Series.
Okay, that's who I'd pick. Toronto is stacked this year.
They're pretty stacked.
And they're playing with a chip on their shoulder after last season. They have to win, and they know it.
They have to kind of win now, yeah.
They have to.
So now, Aaron did something that I thought was a little interesting. He's not going with everybody's favorite, the Cubs. He has the Nationals beating the Cubs, and the Nationals going on to beat the Blue Jays for the World Series.
Interesting. I don't know if I quite agree with that one. I think the Blue Jays are a more talented squad than the Nationals. But it's not too far-fetched, I guess.
All right, great. Can you give me the picks for one Brett Masker,
our editor? Masker. Let's go to Brett Masker's prediction.
I'll give you my thoughts because I got a lot of thoughts about you, Brett. Here they come.
All right, so we're going to break it down for Brett. He has, let's go with the ALDS. We have Seattle winning the wild card against Tampa Bay and going on in to face Houston. And Cleveland against Toronto.
So you and I differ on our opinions about Cleveland. I don't see Cleveland there at all.
All right. Well, he's got the ALCS as Seattle versus Cleveland.
We have moved into fantasy land at this point, and sometimes I worry about, you know, when Brett Masker plays softball with me, about getting hit in the head and losing any more sensibilities than he already has. There is no chance, I'm calling it right now, that Seattle and Cleveland play for the ALCS.
Okay. Over in the NL side, the wild card is St. Louis beating Miami. And so St. Louis goes on to play the Cubs in the NLDS, and the Mets play the Dodgers.
This is so funny when the Mets, I'm willing to just overlook that pick because Miami, what's going to happen is Giancarlo Stanton going to play every position and bat 1 through 9 in the lineup.
Well, and Dee Gordon will be always on base for him.
Well, Dee Gordon will be on base for them.
Yeah,
but
so
I mean,
he'll hit two home runs, 100 of them.
You know what they're missing is an entire rest of the team.
Like, well, they have one pitcher. They have Jose Fernandez.
He's okay. I mean, he's good. He's good. But I mean, like, it just, I don't know how late at night did he send you his picks? Were they like 2 in the morning or something, or?
It was just past midnight.
Okay, it sounds about right. Who did he have in the World Series again?
In the World Series, it was, or at the NLCS first, we have the Cubs against the Mets.
Cubs make a lot of sense. Mets don't make a lot of sense to me at all.
Really?
Is David Wright going to be resurrected into the David Wright that he was 4 years ago?
Not necessarily, but have you
seen
that?
Because if he is, I'll go to my fantasy league right now.
I think he's in our league's fantasy free agent.
He's a free agent out there. But no, I don't see it. I don't see it at all. The Cubs make a lot of sense, but
You don't see that rotation being the scariest rotation in baseball?
It's not the scariest rotation. I mean, it's a good rotation, but the Mets, pitching does win championships, but you have to have a modicum of offense.
You
have to score some
runs.
But
the Giants have proven that you can get away without it.
Giants, let's just assume that the Giants are just some weird, ethereal, other thing.
It's not the rule.
Yeah, if you try to apply the Giants, who don't use sabermetrics, who don't use standard, you know, in-game practices, they Pablo Sandoval was the only guy that hit. They went a whole year where he's the only guy that hit one home run or more. He had like 20 other guys with one home run and 2 RBIs on their stat line. And it just. Anyway, let's not talk about the Giants.
Okay,
They belong in their own little box. No, Cubs. Cubs making a lot of sense.
Okay, but we're going to really enter fantasy land here. Brett's pick for the World Series is Seattle winning 4-3 over the Cubs.
You know what? If that happens, I will buy him a Seattle Mariners jersey that says Abraham was wrong on it.
I would have to buy him something as well.
We'll go in on it. If that weird little fantasy happens, Brett. But if it doesn't happen, you owe us bear. All right.
Sounds good. All right, sounds fair.
Let's go to me. Can I give you my projections and get your feedback on this? So
let's get ready to tear these apart.
So in the ALDS, you have Tampa and the Astros, Toronto and Minnesota.
Okay.
You're not as high on Minnesota as I am, right?
Well, let's first of all, let's say who the wild card was. You had the Rays versus the Mariners.
Oh yeah, I had a lot of question. I wrote Mariners. I'm looking at it right now. I said Seattle Mariners ?
There's about 15 question marks and then about 10 or 11 exclamation points afterwards. 84 wins for the Mariners. But anyway, the ALDS. Minnesota. I'm sorry. Yes, Byron Buxton and Miguel Sano are up for full seasons this year, and they are both incredible prospects.
Yep.
They have a great pitching staff. The rest of the team is solid. I just don't think they're there yet. I think another year, and they'll be in this role, but I just don't think they're there yet.
They do lack a certain level of special. Like everything's solid, but they don't have something that's special. I do get that.
I think you just need another year. You need the young guys to get some seasoning and then move on.
We're talking about the Giants. Well, the Giants are kind of similar too, right? They have a lot of solid role players, but they do have the special guys, your Baumgartners, you know, Pablo Sandoval when he was there, you know, those kind of things. But okay, here's my pick for
the third base bench player for the Boston Red Sox?
Well, no. I mean, he's past his prime, obviously, but
he was paying him for the next 4 seasons.
Well, that's Boston's problem.
$19 million a year or whatever.
That's Boston's problem, not the Giants.
Anyway, yeah.
Giants were smart. They got rid of him. okay, so for the NLDS, the four that made it for my picks were the Giants, the Cubs. I went Miami because I I was talking to Brett Masker, and he convinced me that it was a good idea.
You drank the Kool-Aid?
I drank the Kool-Aid, and then I looked at the roster. So it's too late for me to append that pick, but yeah, Miami and St. Louis.
All right. Well, you know what you did.
I know what I did wrong. I listened to Brett Masker. and then, yes, I looked
at
this.
Yeah, they're not going to win. They're not going to beat St. Louis. No. St. Louis is just like the Astros. They're poised. They have the depth. They have the talent. They have the young guys. They have the old guys. Their rotation is amazing. I think they're set.
For the ALCS, I have Toronto and Tampa. Now, I'm on the Tampa wagon. Not a lot of people are on the Tampa wagon right now, but I like them.
They're young. They're exciting. They've got a great rotation. They have too many ex-Mariners, though. But then again, that's a good thing, usually. Because when you leave the Mariners, then you're good.
Not when that ex-Mariner is Logan Morrison, though, right?
Well, not just Logan Morrison, but Brad Miller and Nick Franklin.
Well, I like Brad Miller. Nick Franklin, I haven't...
Actually, he didn't make the roster.
I don't think he's really going to contribute, right?
Yeah, he didn't make the roster.
I think Brad Miller might be that one pick. I agree with Ian Loney, one of our baseball writers and editors. He's a big Brad Miller fan, and he wrote an article that said that's the one that the Mariners are going to regret. And that's possible.
Very possible. Yeah. Very possible.
The only problem is he just couldn't play shortstop, right?
Not really as well as Ketel Marte or Chris Taylor could.
Not at a major league, A-plus level.
He didn't project as a shortstop.
Let's see here. So for the World Series, Toronto beating the Giants.
Well, you know, I mean, it is an even numbered year.
It is an even numbered year.
So San Francisco should be there.
Right.
Toronto beating them, very possible. Toronto is picked by a lot of people to go all the way this year.
Can I just make one little comment about the Cubs?
Sure.
The Cubs could very likely go to the World Series. But now a part of me, because everybody's on the Cubs bandwagon, a part of me doesn't want anybody that likes the Cubs to win. You guys are getting just as bad as Red Sox fans. Once the Red Sox started winning World Series, they get all up in your face about it. Nah, you know what? I hate going to Safeco Field and there's a billion like Blue Jay fans or Red Sox fans or Cub fans.
Oh, yeah.
It's annoying. I don't like it. Hope you guys lose. Anyway, that was just an editorial right there. Who do we have next?
Brent Goodwin.
Goodwine. All right, great.
I'll do Brent Goodwine next. Let's see here. We have...
he's our Husky football editor, but he also watches a lot of baseball.
A lot of baseball, yeah. Here we go. So out of the AL West, he's got the Astros. And the Central, apparently, he's a little bit behind. Cleveland Spiders.
Cleveland Spiders. That's a good team. They could keep... Who else does he have?
The Blue Jays, and then the Rays and the Red Sox are the wild cards.
Mm, okay, so...
So he's got Toronto against Cleveland and Tampa versus Houston.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of the Cleveland Spiders. I think they'll go far. They'll go as far as their pitching takes them. You ever notice that's the regular like response when you don't know what to say about something?
Yeah, their pitching's good.
They'll go as far as their defense takes them.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, it relies on the arm of the quarterback, that kind of thing.
They're going to win the game if they score more points than the other team.
I assume you meant the Indians. Obviously. Yeah. but I think the Red Sox are the odd team out, but you never know. I mean, it's now with the wild card, teams can slip in every once in a while.
It's true, but when your third baseman, supposed star third baseman, is sitting on the bench, that's kind of hard. That's kind of a blow.
Yeah.
When the alternative is a guy who's probably only going to hit 10 to 15 dingers and maybe 280.
Also, who saw the rapid declining status of Dustin Pedroia? I thought that guy would keep going forever, but he's an average player.
He's sunk into obscurity. He really has.
Would you say he's obscure or just average?
Well, he's blended back in. If you're not a Boston fan, you never hear his name anymore.
Exactly. Yeah.
So anyway, we'll move to the NL here. He's got the Giants and the Cubs, then the Mets, and then the Cardinals and the Dodgers being the wild cards.
Cardinals and Dodgers. Wait. Cubs. So, the Giants.
So,
Cubs.
So the Giants. Versus the Cardinals, and then the Cubs versus the Mets.
So Brent Goodwine and Brett Masker live near each other, so I think he's drinking the Mets Kool-Aid, and I'm...
All right.
No, I mean, it's pretty solid. It's just the Mets I don't like in that. Everything else makes sense there.
All right, so then the World Series, we have San Francisco beating Toronto.
San Francisco
just
beat
the reverse of the last one.
Yeah, opposite of me. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, which is quite reasonable.
Very reasonable.
You know, and it, like we said, it is an even numbered year. It's time.
Can I give you the picks for Kevin?
Yes.
All
sure.
right, Kevin, our social media guru and one of the owners of SSU, he has in the American League Divisional Series, Toronto, Seattle, Detroit, and Texas. Little thing out there. Detroit is where he's from.
Yeah.
So there's a little
Motor
bit of hometown.
City Kitties. He likes the Motor City Kitties.
What do you think of his picks there?
I think it's a little high on Seattle, to be honest. We're not going to win the division.
You're okay with Detroit, though?
Detroit, you know, the honest thing is that I don't know who's going to come out of the AL Central.
Like
we said, it's weak. It could literally be anybody. You don't know. Tigers still have a dangerous rotation. They still have Miggy Cabrera. They still have JD Martinez. They still have Victor Martinez.
Some
good heart to the lineup. You never know.
All right. And in the National League, he has the Nationals, the Cubs, the Giants, with Pittsburgh and St. Louis also in there.
Okay.
As the wild cards, Pittsburgh
all
and St.
Right.
Louis.
I can see that.
Excellent. Right, so whatever fantasy land that Brent Masker is living in, Kevin may also have a ticket there, and that he picked Detroit versus Seattle in the ALCS.
It's two teams.
His hometown versus his new hometown.
Yeah, that's not going to happen for either team. I'm sorry, no. Detroit might sneak into the playoffs, Seattle might sneak into the playoffs, but they're not going to make it to the final round. Mm. Of the AL.
You know what? If he wins that, I might have to get him a hat that's like half Detroit and half Seattle.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Get two hats, cut them in half, and then stitch them together.
But it's not going to happen, so I won't worry about how difficult that is.
That is pretty
difficult. Let's see here. For the NLCS, he has the Nationals versus the Pirates.
Yeah, you know, the Pirates haven't been getting a lot of love in our projections.
No, they have not. They have not. They're a good team.
They are a very solid team from top to bottom. They do have their own superstar. And Mr. McCutcheon.
Yep.
They have a couple of the good, great, great underrated supporting cast around him. That outfield is probably the best in baseball. Polanco and McCutcheon and Sterling Marte. Arguably that's the best in baseball. And their rotation is very good from top to bottom. I can see them going far.
Excellent.
They're not. I mean, it's not that crazy of a pick.
And the World Series, of course. Kevin's going to take Detroit versus Washington Nationals.
Not going to happen, Kevin. I'm sorry. That will not happen. Detroit's not going to the World Series this year.
All right. What do you think of the Nationals, though?
The Nationals have a real shot at the World Series, in my opinion.
Okay.
They do have the depth. They do have the pitching. And like I said, Bryce Harper is leading them now, finally. So he stepped up. And, yeah, you know, they're a team to be reckoned with.
All right. Great. Do we have one more?
Let's see.
Do we have Ian Loney's?
Ian Loney. Of course, we gotta have Ian Loney.
Okay.
Here we go. Okay.
All right. What are we?
Ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm ready to mock our baseball writer and editor Ian Loney.
All right. So out of the East, we have in the AL, of course, we've got Boston, then Cleveland, Houston winning the West, and then Toronto and Seattle in the wild card. He's added a note here that Seattle wins the wild card game because Felix throws a complete game shutout against Toronto.
Wow, that's a very specific projection.
So it's Seattle versus Houston and Cleveland versus Boston.
The only problem I would have with that is I think Toronto is going to crush the entire AL East. So I don't see them as a wild card team.
I see them beating Boston definitely in that spot.
Cleveland, you and I argue about Cleveland. We've already talked about that. I don't see Cleveland, but the rest of it sounds fine. The rest of it sounds good.
Okay, so then we're going to go on to Seattle losing to Houston, Cleveland beating Boston. So that's Houston-Cleveland in the ALCS.
Okay.
And he's got Houston winning there.
I could see Houston winning and going to the World Series. You bet.
And then in the NL, we've got the Nationals, the Cubs, and then the Giants with the Cardinals and Dodgers being the wild card.
It's pretty strong. I can't really argue with that. I mean,
those are the powerhouses.
You could pick and move. Yeah. those are the five best teams in the National
League. They really are. So. Yeah. And the
don't
the,
drink the Miami Marlins juice like I do.
And the Cardinals, win that. So it'd be Cubs versus Cardinals and Giants versus Nats.
Oh, what about TV ratings for that Cubs and Cardinals? That'd be amazing.
That would be amazing, yeah. So the Cubs win and the Giants win. So the Cubs against the Giants in the NLCS, he has the Cubs winning. So the Cubs versus the Astros in the World Series, and he has the Cubs winning. So he has the Cubs winning the World Series.
Yeah, he's the only one. And maybe he's one of those bandwagon Cubs fans that... I don't know. It could happen. I mean, they have a good team up and down the lineup.
It's, you know, we all said it couldn't happen for Boston, and then it did.
It finally did, yeah.
So we're ready for the next team to fall, I guess.
I'd be rooting for the Astros in that series. All right. Well, we got to run a break, and I know that your picks, you're choosing to save those for your article. Where you
yes. Tune in or check out our site, SeattleSportsUnion.com. Later on tonight, I'll have everyone's picks up there plus mine. And you can see how the real expert picks.
Excellent. We're going to do a little special segment coming up here after the break where we go through our fantasy picks and some of our ideas of, you know, how well we did picking teams and some good strategies that you might want to employ during your fantasy baseball season.
All right.
We'll be back with SSU Live in a minute. Welcome back to SSU Live. My name is Abraham Deweson. With me is Matt Page. Behind the camera, we have one Bob Lucky. And right now, we're going to talk a little bit about our fantasy baseball league. We have just finished our picks. Well, we did that a week ago.
Yeah.
And we have now been able to look at our rosters and come up with some interesting tidbits that you, the viewer, might want to learn a little bit about. And we also have some strategies that we're gonna pass on to you. Let's first talk about the best pick in the draft. One of our friends, Sanju, this is a keeper league. Let me start off with this. Sanju had several good players. However, because we shrunk our league, some players got thrown into the mix, into the free agency pool, including one Mike Trout.
And Bryce Harper.
And Bryce Harper got thrown in there as well.
And Manny Machado.
So, shut up. Be quiet. Let me get to my best draft pick.
Okay.
Or my favorite draft pick, and that was Sanju choosing to not keep anybody to nail the top pick and get one Mike Trout.
I have to agree that, I mean, that was the best move. It worked out great for him because he had the first overall pick.
What would you call the second best move then?
You know, I have to admire the risk that our co-owner and
social media guru. You could also use his name, Kevin.
Kevin.
You could just say Kevin. That.
I have to admire what he did.
And you sit next to him at work and you forgot.
He always forgets other people's names. Hey, you're going to go get pizza. Yeah. And I'm like, whatever. Okay. Anyway, I admire what Kevin did the same thing in an attempt to get Bryce Harper, and it didn't work out for him. He ultimately wound up taking Manny Machado with the fifth overall pick. But I do admire the courage it took to totally reset and dive back in and knowing you're not going to get Mike Trout and you're probably not going to get Bryce Harper, but you're still resetting your team and rebuilding from ground one when square one, when everyone else has a leg up. Like I kept Giancarlo Stanton and you kept, Josh Donaldson.
Yeah.
You know, so there were some big players who were kept and.
Oh, you know,
it takes courage to reset.
I'd like to throw another one out there too. Katrina, who had the very last pick in the draft, in our snake draft, that means she also gets the first pick of the second round. So what she did is she only kept one keeper. She kept Clayton Kershaw, got the 10th pick with Clayton Kershaw, and then that opened up that next pick. Her very next pick is wide open to whatever free agent that she wanted. And that, I thought that was a bold move, you know, not... Make the draft work for you instead of working against the draft.
Then you get two really good picks, and she actually chose Greinke. She went with the last year's...
Did you like that pick?
Anchors. I thought Greinke actually might have been a bit of a reach early.
Okay, that might be. The worst pick, in my opinion.
Not necessarily the worst pick. I think it's a bit of a reach, and the reason why is because he's now playing for the Arizona Diamondbacks, which is a little bit more of a friendly hitter field than Dodger Stadium is. He's not going to get the run support that he did in Dodger Stadium. And, you know, I mean, he's more there's more strain on him. He's going to be the ace. Whereas at the Giant or the Dodgers, he was the number two guy. Kershaw handled all that, and he didn't have to worry. He could relax and just be the number two guy and just kind of chill. There really is a level of stress added when you're the ace and you're being held accountable to a higher level.
So I wouldn't call this necessarily the worst pick.
It's a reach.
Yeah, it's a reach. Oh, well, you know what? I just thought of something. There was another nifty little draft strategy that somebody did.
Okay.
And it failed for them. Steve Taniguchi.
Oh.
He decided not to keep Edwin Encarnacion. He dropped him because he went ahead and grabbed. He did get Bryce Harper. I mean that's a win.
Yes.
But he allowed Encarnacion to go to another team.
If you look at a direct comparison, I'd rather have Bryce Harper than Edwin Encarnacion.
Yeah, I guess so. It's just you could have. I think he could have got more quality. I take that back. I think he could have got quantity of quality over a top star and then booting the next pick. Okay. I don't know. Just a thought on my part. I just came into my head.
It depends on what your overall strategy is. A lot of folks like to build the killer pitching staff. Like Aaron, who's going to be a writer on our staff this year for baseball. He decided that he wanted to have the mother of all pitching staffs. And let me tell you, he really does.
I'll pull it up here. What did you like about that strategy, though?
It's not a strategy that I would ever, ever consider. And I've been doing fantasy baseball now for 16 years. First time I ever did it was the year 2000. And I've tried pretty much every strategy possible along the way. And it's not a strategy I ever recommend. And the reason why, you got this.
Yeah, here are the guys, but tell us the reason why first.
The reason why is because it's much easier to build a solid, not top tier, but it's much easier to build a solid pitching staff than it is to build a solid offense. The number of guys who can hit, like Bryce Harper versus Edwin Encarnacion, the number of guys who can hit a 40-plus homers a year is like that many.
Yeah, very few.
The number of guys who will win 15-plus wins games is up here. There's a lot more of them. You can scavenge the free agent wire. You can build a pitching staff after the draft, really. But the big, big, big bats, there are few and far between, and the guys who are behind them, there's a reason why they're behind them, and you're never going to catch up to the people who have a big stockpile.
So Aaron has Steven Strasburg, Corey Kluber, Adam Wainwright, Cole Hamels, and these are all guys in the top 100.
And Quintana.
And Jose Quintana. But the first four were all in the top
100. Man, yeah. And
That's not bad. And actually, he didn't really...
Honest truth is he kind of lucked into it. He didn't set out to do that, right?
Well, keep this in mind. He didn't really boot offense, though, because he, as keepers, he kept Paul Goldschmidt and Sterling Marte.
No.
He just kept Goldschmidt, yeah.
Yeah. He just kept Goldschmidt, and then with his second overall pick, he was going to keep Chris Bryant, and as a second overall pick, he got Chris Bryant. So
yeah, okay.
He was pretty excited about that.
All right, so got a question for you about a strategy that I employed and ended up dead last. I was third to last year.
Okay.
I went with all rookies. And boy, oh boy, do rookies go down to the minor leagues really quickly.
It's fun. It is fun to build a roster of hot prospects. It really kind of is. It's great. It's exciting because they're, you know, they have flashes of brilliance and you're like, yes, he's turned the corner. He's going to be an amazing pitcher. But then the next time they go out and they get shelled for 14 runs or something like that.
I'd say I learned my lesson, especially with the pitchers. Because the pitchers, yeah, they...
You've got to be very careful in how you do it. And you got to look at the matchups for the young pitchers. And you got to only pick the favorable one. You might miss some good good outings, but you got to really hold their hand. And you can do it. I've won a league once doing that, but it was a wild ride. Let me put it that way. Very inconsistent, very up and down, up and down, up and down all season. And they just kind of all clicked at the end to give me that last little oomph. But Just for the record, you said you finished third to last.
Third to last, yes.
I finished, well, second because I lost in the finals, but I was winning the league for the entire season.
There's no supporter shield for...
I should get a supporter
shield.
No,
you don't get one.
I should get one.
You don't get one. But you lost. You lost to a person. You lost to Katrina, who had never played fantasy sports ever.
Yeah. What happened was all my players just broke down.
No,
stretch.
No, she beat you.
I lost Giancarlo Stanton for the year.
Oh,
I lost
big deal.
Miguel Cabrera for most of the year.
Oh, talk to me about injuries.
I lost like half my pitching staff to injuries. I traded my one Cardinal pitcher, which, by the way,
get a Cardinal pitcher.
One strategy: always have a Cardinal pitcher
and a Rockies hitter.
And a Rockies hitter also helps, but absolute requirement. This is what happened last year. I traded away Trevor Rosenthal, my one Cardinals pitcher, and what happened? I lost the finals.
So I got a question for you. My draft strategy wasn't too dissimilar to Aaron's. What I did is I kept three keepers on offense so that I had lockdowns on steals with D. Gordon. Mm-hmm. I had the five-tool guy in Andrew McCutchen.
Okay.
And then I wanted Josh Donaldson for home run uh-huh. power. So then what I did is I focused on pitching. And I don't know. You say Aaron's is amazing. I love these guys. I have Felix Hernandez, Garrett Cole, John Lester, and Danny Salazar. And those are four guys in the top 100 as well. And those are going to get me wins. And I love that.
Yeah, no, there's absolutely nothing wrong with them. And actually, one surprising note, I have to say, in this draft, for once, the first time in the Seattle area draft I've ever seen, Felix did not go too early.
True.
Felix actually went, you actually drafted him at a very reasonable part of the draft.
I think it was the fifth round or something like that.
Which is very reasonable at that time. And that was great. That is a very, very solid pitching staff.
So
there is nothing, no weaknesses there at all that I see.
So I think I told all of you guys before the draft,
uh-huh.
I absolutely would not draft any Seattle Mariners because I am not a homer, and every time I do it, I get disappointed and really angry at that player.
And how many did you wind up with?
I drafted three and almost four.
For the record,
what was your strategy? What was your strategy?
I drafted. Oops. Okay.
Did you draft a Mariner too?
I did not draft a Mariner.
Oh, okay.
That's what I try to do is I try to stick with players that I know are going to be on those powerhouse teams, players that I know will have the most opportunity to succeed. So they'll have the best lineup around them. They'll have the best pitching staff around them. They'll get the best run support, etc. Their pitchers in pitcher parks, etc.
They're going to have runners on base in front of them.
I don't have as big a pitching staff as you in terms of starting rotation. I've got Dallas Keuchel, which I kept less from last year.
So you went with guys on good teams, basically.
Noah Syndergaard, he's going to be the ace of Mets by the time the season's over. Michael Wacha from St. Louis. I had to have my St. Louis pitcher in there.
Yep, yep.
Shelby Miller, he's now in Arizona. He played for...
That could be a problem.
That's not actually not a problem. He played. He lost, what, like 15 games last year? Yep. Why? Because he was in Atlanta. Okay?
Good point.
That means that he pitched late enough in the game.
Well, so what was your hitting strategy?
My hitting strategy, as always, is big bats combined with some guys that I think are going to have some rebound years.
Well, you probably had the best two keepers.
Giancarlo Stanton and Miguel Cabrera were my keepers.
Yeah.
Along with Dallas.
So you have the home runs locked down.
I added JD Martinez in the early round. I added Prince Fielder a little bit later, and I added Yasiel Puig. And then on top of that, my bounce back candidate for the season is Ian Desmond. He's eligible at short. He's going to be playing left field for Texas, but he's eligible at short.
Well, Texas is a bandbox.
And it's a bandbox. It's a stacked lineup. You know, he's going there to help rebuild his value, so he's motivated. It's a one-year contract, so it's a contract year. He's very capable. I think we'll see some good things from him.
Well, one thing that we did learn is this is probably the worst lineup of catchers I've ever seen in my life.
Oh, they're all the same.
In 15 years of fantasy.
What are you talking about? No, they all produce. They're all the same.
I drafted a guy I never heard of before.
Who did you draft? Oh, Devin Mesorosco?
With the very last pick. Wow. I basically look for a guy who's going to have more than like 400 at bats.
Okay. I picked Wellington Castillo, who you might remember was a Mariner for about 5 minutes last year.
Right, but we hated him so much that we sent him to Arizona.
For Mark Trumbo.
Where he did amazingly well.
Yeah, he turned the corner
for a catcher,
pretty damn awesome. And I think we're going to see big things from this year, hopefully. If not, it's a catcher. There's like literally, I mean, Yadier Molina,
Buster Posey.
Yadier Molina is in our free agent bin right now because because he was hurt last year.
Sorry, what I was going to say is though that you got Buster Posey
and then nothing else.
And then
it's not what it once was. It's not an absolute wasteland.
It is
generally
a wasteland.
Generally now the average catcher in baseball will have about around 450 at bats. We'll get hit about 250 to 260. We'll get about 10 to 15 dingers. Won't steal any bases. Won't really produce in runs or RBIs. But there's like 30 of those guys that do that. And there's Buster Posey, who's definitely up a notch. But then, once you come down from Buster Posey, they're all basically the same. You can change the name. It doesn't matter.
I was sitting there staring at it, and I thought to myself, why would I even pick one until...
Just randomly. Just pick one.
Yeah, well, I went with at-bats.
Yeah.
Because I just want to make sure there's somebody that can...
That's a regular starter. Yeah.
Yeah. So I looked at it, and it stated that there were something to the effect of like 20 catchers. Here it is, like in the 18th, 19th round, because nobody has picked a catcher.
Oh yeah, nobody took a pass. You take catcher last. It's like kicker in fantasy football.
Yeah, exactly.
You take a kicker in the very last pick because there really is no difference.
Unless you're basically.
There might be one or two that are like really awesome, and then after that, it's like there's like 10 that are the same.
So we have a new scoring format for our fantasy league. I know a lot of you out there, play fantasy with just a standard 5x5.
Five by five roto.
Yep. But we went with something different this year. We added some negative.
Commish.
I, the commissioner, because nobody's a man enough to be commissioner, just me. Actually, everybody's too lazy to be commissioner.
We don't want to deal with people.
And anyway, so we added a couple of negatives, and that includes errors and losses. What do you think about having a couple of negative stats in the lineup?
I like it. Last couple of years I've been bouncing around the idea of having a negative stats league.
Yeah.
You draft the worst players possible, but the problem with that is that the worst players don't really play often enough. So
yeah,
really,
you gotta have somebody
there's
that's bad
there.
Enough to like not be
But anyway, so I like it. It adds an extra layer. We have to watch out for bad fielders. I didn't really consider that too much, but the honest truth is that I think projected on my team, Ian Desmond is going to hit 27 errors or something like that.
Whoops.
On short, but he's not playing short.
But he's not playing short anymore.
He's playing left. And
he won't have
no
the opportunities.
Way you're going to get that many errors.
He won't have that many opportunities to, screw
up. In left. But, I like the losses. That's also that was a big part of my strategy as far as picking players that are on the best teams. They'll have the best opportunity to win. You don't know. Till the games are played, obviously. We'll see, but...
A couple other changes I made. We're not going to discuss the on-base percentage because that's me. Nobody gets to say nothing. I love that stat because I'm an Edgar Martinez fan, and everybody should be an Edgar Martinez fan. The guy's great, and he's Mr. On-Base Percentage himself.
I'm thoroughly okay with that because I have Miguel Cabrera.
Oh, is he...
Who's like the king of on-base percentage right now.
Oh, well, there you go. Okay.
So I'm okay with that.
I just finished an article about Jerry DePoto, the new Mariners GM. It's called Control the Zone. What is it? And, well, that's not the real title of it. The real title of it is, did you change my title?
No.
Jerry DePoto's Theology to Control the Zone. What does it mean to the Mariners?
I capitalized theology. That's all I did.
Okay, thank you. So Control the Zone is a very, it's not inherently anti-on-base percentage, but it's a more aggressive tack to batting. And yes, our fantasy league is kind of going anti-CTZ, Control the Zone, on this, but I love on-base percentage. Net saves and holds. I didn't go with saves. I went with net saves and holds.
I love this
what
because
do you think about that?
It makes ace relievers, setup guys, that much more valuable. I used to build entire rosters. I used to play in an NL-only keeper league that was 14 teams big, and we would scour the absolute, NL only, so there's not even DHs. Players like a Willie Bloomquist, who is absolutely worthless in reality, would be like incredibly valuable because he got regular at bats. We used to play in those kind of leagues, and I would build entire pitching staffs out of guys like Charlie Furbush and, you know,
some middle relievers.
You know, middle, well, like setup guys, like Benoit, you know, for us this year. I would build entire teams out of that. And this gives credit to that. You know, it gives, yeah, it opens it up. It's not just closers. It's not just, you know, closers getting all that, one hot, one-sided, you know, category, and you, yeah, have to go and buy a closer from someone later on.
You're picking
season.
Up, you're picking up Fernando Rodney last year because he gets saves. In which case, you might as well just say, who cares about saves?
Yeah, well, and instead in that situation, you can pick up Carson Smith, who was getting tons of holds.
Oh, yeah.
And was doing really well. So you could have had Carson Smith instead of Fernando Rodney, and your overall ERA and WHIP would be way better.
And you're actually picking a worthwhile person.
You're picking, yeah, you're picking a person that actually pitches and is a decent human being.
All right, just before we run a break, I'd like to get from you, who's the best real life player who's a terrible fantasy pick? In other words, who does really well at stats in a, let's just say, a regular 5x5 league?
Wait, so who's really good at in fantasy but terrible in person?
Who's great in real life but terrible in fantasy? Actually, the next question I'm going to ask is the complete opposite of that. So you can go in whichever order you want. Worst player in real life who's great at fantasy, or and best player in real life. And for example, for me, Adrian Beltre is that guy right now who is not great in fantasy numbers, but boy oh boy, I'd love to have him as my third baseman.
Okay, well then I have to take the same tactic with the shortstop that the Angels acquired, Andrelton Simmons, on the offseason from Atlanta. This kid is a machine as far as defense at short.
Mm-hmm.
He'll never hit, you know, 350 dingers or whatever like that. So he's never going to be on anyone's fantasy team. But he is the player you would love to have as your shortstop on your roster. And they do.
And then I guess the other one, and I do have Felix Hernandez, but, you know, he, like you were saying, he just doesn't get wins because the stinking Mariners can't seem to produce runs whenever he pitches.
That might change this year. We'll see.
We'll see. I mean, but, like, I'm just saying.
So, great in real historically, life, but terrible in stats. Yeah.
Historically, if you were to create your own baseball team, that's one of the guys that you go after first in all of baseball, you know, because actual aces at a Clayton Kershaw, Felix Hernandez level are rare.
Very rare.
Yeah.
In terms of lights out. There are plenty of pitchers out there that are good enough to be the number one on the team, but there's a number one on your starting rotation, and then there's an actual ace that, like, scares batters.
Right.
And can control the game, and that you want starting in Game 7 of the World Series. And those guys, yeah, like
so
you said.
What about the other way around? What about your, like, Who would you say is like a, let's go with Fernando Rodney, right? Where he is terrible in real life, but he gets those save numbers. Do you have anybody like that either on your team right now?
Yes,
you're worried
right
about?
On my team, I have one of those players.
Who do you have?
Billy Hamilton. Billy Hamilton steals like nobody's business, okay? The kid had, what, like 65 last year or something crazy. And in today's league, that's way more than the average. And I stashed him on my reserve because I realized all of a sudden halfway through the draft that I had no steals whatsoever. The reality is, though, he can never get on base. He bats like 215 on the season. And he doesn't have the plate discipline to succeed at the major league level in terms of hitting. If the dude could take a walk every now and then, he might be a lot more valuable. And those 65 steals might become like 120.
Excellent. But all right. Well, yeah. Well, that's it for fantasy right now. We are SSU Live. We're going to run to a break and come back and talk a little bit about ESPN and World Wrestling Entertainment.
What do those two things have to do with each other?
What do they have to do with each other? We don't know.
Stay tuned and find out.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome to SSU Live. My name is Abraham DeWeese, and with me is Matt Page. We are Seattle Sports Union. We have a lot of great articles on our website, seattlesportsunion.com, and we have a lot of great videos here on YouTube at SSU Live. Please leave comments below. Let us know your opinions on baseball, football, Mariners, Seahawks, Huskies, all the sports here in the Seattle area.
Tell us we suck. Tell us we're awesome. You know, just say hi.
Yeah.
We love it all.
We love it all. All right. This is our last segment, and we're just going to cover something that I thought was quite interesting. So, today is WrestleMania. Today, the biggest event in professional wrestling occurs. Or, I'm sorry, sports entertainment. but we
They are athletes.
They are athletes.
But I mean, they really are.
But we have, you know, we're all, you know, ancillary fans. Every once in a while, we'll pick up the Royal Rumble or WrestleMania and watch it. But I noticed ESPN last night and today have been running all sorts of, not just advertisements, but actual segments on WWE. And I thought to myself, why is ESPN picking up WWE? You know, maybe as like a highlight on a really late night, you know, broadcast, that might be kind of amusing as a comedy piece. But why are they doing actual coverage? Why are they not keeping up more with the NCAA tournament, both men's and women's? And why are they not talking more about baseball?
Oh, it's opening day. Like you said, they got Final Four. They've got hockey still playing. There's basketball currently occurring professionally.
NBA, we don't know. I don't know. We don't have a team.
Somebody
told me once.
I'm sure it's happening somewhere.
Yeah.
The point is that there is a lot going on this weekend that they could be covering, and they're covering
wrestling. Well, heck, you have.
It's not even real wrestling.
In the NBA. Aren't the Golden State Warriors like on some sort of huge run right now
that they're breaking all the records? Trend, I don't know.
But we wouldn't know.
I wouldn't know.
Because ESPN's not.
Well, yeah, and the NBA told Seattle that they don't want us. So, you know.
That's not the topic here, though. The topic here is why isn't ESPN shoving that down people's
throats? There is a lot that they could be covering.
And the
reality is it's money.
Is it money?
I think.
Is there demand for it?
No, I think it's more the money. WWE is paying lots of money.
Do you know that?
I do not know that. I'm making an absolute opinion.
Let's make that clear. I mean,
complete speculation. I believe that it is money, and I think that Mr. McMahon is paying them quite a pretty penny. And ESPN has shown in the past that they're totally willing to take money, judging from the billions of ads.
Okay, so again. That's an opinion of yours,
yes.
but it's not going to fly unless the advertisers are cool with it. It's not going to fly unless people are turning the channel and watching something else. Ultimately, you know, if they're showing WWE in prime time last night, you know, they were showing it on ESPN, you know, in correlation while the Final Four is going on.
Yeah, that's. You know,
then somebody would be inclined to maybe flip the channel, right?
The thing is though, is they have such a stranglehold, and they have such a stranglehold on modern day sports in terms of television broadcasting.
Yeah.
So they are the only real source you can really turn to try and get, you know,
at a national level. Yeah.
To get that kind of sports news and stuff. So they really don't care.
But Fox Sports has fumbled every shot they've had.
Yeah.
Fox Sports 1 should be a better channel than it is, and I don't know why.
It really should. Their website is quality, has some great journalists on it.
Yep.
But their shows are just, yeah.
I don't understand their. Also, you can't seem to get that at half the bars in town.
There is also the accessibility thing. You know, on basic cable you get ESPN, but on basic cable you don't get Fox Sports 1.
Doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
So you have to pay more. Fox needs to invest more in order to get into the sports.
So
get into people's
boxes. So given that they don't really have much challenge. Yeah, not much challenging them. Why run all the WWE? And I'm not saying I hate professional wrestling. I'm going to watch WrestleMania today, so don't get me wrong on that. But I mean, maybe their advertising worked. Maybe they're
no. I was saying by saying that they have the monopoly, I'm saying that they don't care that they take that $1 million check or what, couple million dollars theoretically they take those couple million dollars from WWE and then they just spam coverage of it.
Okay, well, what if they didn't take money?
It doesn't matter that people are objecting to it or the advertisers are objecting to it because it's only one weekend or one day or whatever.
Well, we don't even know that the advertisers are objecting to it, though.
No, they wouldn't.
They might like it a lot.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people do watch WrestleMania.
Yes.
They may not watch anything else.
It's the biggest event of the year for WWE. So it's kind of their Super Bowl.
And they always have celebrities on there. And there's a certain Jerry Springer type mentality to it, right?
It's almost the same demographic as NASCAR, I want to say. It's not.
I would say it's a wider demographic.
It's a wider demographic than NASCAR, but think of how big a following NASCAR has. How the run race. They're just behind the NFL in terms of ratings. They are very close in terms of ratings. For every race, and the same demographic loves WWE.
You know what though?
So there is a big sample out there.
I've actually read articles about that. The demographic, and I assume the demographic you're talking about is Southern and white.
Generally Southern, generally white,
but
generally lower income.
About 10, let's say, actually, wow, it's now about 20 years ago, that whole WWE Attitude Era changed all the demographics, or added new demographics.
Well, it expanded it. It didn't like turn them off if they were down there or whatever.
Right. But, you know, I mean, so WWE still has some names that are left over that people might remember. Undertaker, Triple H, Chris Jericho, and Brock Lesnar. Those are all names, I would say, if you go down the street, people might have heard of a couple of those guys, right?
I've heard of Undertaker. Everyone's heard of Undertaker.
Everybody's heard of Undertaker.
Triple H.
And Brock Lesnar, right?
Brock Lesnar was an MMA fighter for a while.
Yeah, so
he crossed over into MMA, and that got some across the field there.
And then Chris Jericho has a band.
Okay.
There are people I know that know his band and don't know anything about wrestling.
Oh, all right.
Yeah.
I didn't know he had a band.
It's not a good band. It's definitely not good music.
Oh,
but
okay.
It is a touring band.
So it's like Christian rock. Is that what you're saying? Not good music.
You don't like Petra?
No. Anyway,
I can't name any other Christian. Well, maybe Creed.
Creed.
Right? Creed.
Okay. Dude, by the way, actually, I learned yesterday. They were once did so poorly at a show that they got sued by their fans, and the fans won. That's how bad Creed was.
Oh, but you have their songs on your iPod.
Can you take
me higher? No. My favorite part is Creed. Creed insisted they were not Christian rock.
Nope, they're not, but they totally are. Anyway, moving back around to ESPN.
Oh yeah. Anyway, back to our rant.
I don't. You know, I mean, the reality is, I understand they're athletes. What they do is incredibly physical and incredibly, they have to be incredibly in shape. It's amazing some of the things that they can pull off in the ring. But it's sports entertainment, like you called it. It's not technically a sport. It is not really wrestling. It is not really, it doesn't follow the rules of wrestling or anything regarding that. It's not technically, there aren't any real rules that are followed. It's technically entertainment. It's almost just, storylines are basically a soap opera.
So almost like ESPN is sports entertainment network?
Yeah. They don't really follow the real sport. I don't know. It's, yeah.
Entertainment Sports Network is what it is.
It's,
that's what ESPN is, right?
Well, yeah, no.
Entertainment Sports Network.
Okay, so have we talked about Tebow yet today? No. Well, let's talk about Peyton Manning. Well, no, let's talk about LeBron. No, let's go back to Tebow.
What's the most salacious?
What's Mark Sanchez done to screw himself lately? You know, that's what they do. What's Johnny Manziel doing? No one cares. But for some reason, they spend three quarters of the day talking about these same five big guys.
It drives me nuts too, because I really do like the NFL Network, and I don't have NFL Network, but you know, when I get the rare opportunity to watch it, it's quality. And when I watch, what's the football show they have on? I think it's HBO.
It's like This Week in Football.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
It's good. It's real good.
Yeah,
I forget the name, but it's good.
Some good stuff. And I don't know, for some reason, ESPN really wants to emphasize that entertainment part of their acronym.
Yeah, they kind of embrace the CNN model of let's show all the Twitter tweets and let's sit there and have the anchor read what Joe 65 said. Da, 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 da. And it's like, I don't care what Joe 65 said. I really don't. I mean, I want to hear news as to what's happening in sports.
And when they're getting all their news
see the
off
recap of the game. And
when they get their news off of, this is what really bugs me, when they get their news off of Twitter feeds of an athlete, and everybody knows this, but people don't seem to get this through their skulls, that when you read a message in text form, you're missing all sorts of intent.
Oh, yeah.
What was this? Was this meant as a
context,
joke?
Context, too.
Context, yeah. Was it a joke, or was this, you know,
sarcastic,
or is this just a guy talking to his friend just to blow off steam?
Yeah, what's the inflection? You don't know. But they'll literally have a tweet up there, and the commentators on SportsCenter will spend 5 minutes talking about that tweet. And it's like, guys, there isn't really, I mean.
Well, yeah, what are some of the ridiculous ones? Like an image of an athlete and he's, you know, wearing Reebok shoes out, you know, what about his Nike contract with, you know,
I don't care.
Yeah, who cares?
Reebok or Nike care, and that's fine. That's their job to care, but we don't care at all. We want to see this opening day, or we want to see Final Four coverage, or we want to see women's Final Four coverage, or we want to see hockey coverage, or we want to see.
I would rather watch
the National Basketball Association. Is that what it is?
I think that's NBA, what they call it. Yeah.
NBA. Yeah, we want to see coverage of that.
But here. Okay, I would rather watch. There was this YouTube thing I watched earlier today where they had two teams in the same rowboat. And they're doing rowboat tug of war.
Yes.
And so you have like four guys on one side of this long boat and four guys on the other. And there's a line right down the middle. And they're like, row, row, row. And they're rowing like facing against each other.
Yeah.
And so the boat's going like this. And like at the end of the minute, like whoever has the most of the boat. I would rather watch that than freaking Stephen A. Smith and...
Skip Bayless.
Oh, the unspeakable one. Yes.
These guys are literally now. Sorry, your ears here. These guys are professional assholes. They are paid to be professional assholes.
Bob, mute that.
On their W-2 form, where job classification, it says professional asshole. They are paid to say crazy stuff and hope it sticks, and then stir up controversy and try and start feuds with Richard Sherman.
Right. Right.
And Richard Sherman wins at life against Skip Bayless, which is correct.
But this is the whole entertainment part of it, right? They're entertainers, and that's where ESPN is right now. And I don't know, we may have just sunk ourselves ever getting hired by ESPN, but I don't care. That's not real sport.
I don't want to work for them.
Show some games. Today is the opening of Major League Baseball. And
I should be getting blanket coverage.
Instead of shaking hands with Vince McMahon and doing... I don't know, you know, interviews with, you know, old 50-year-old wrestlers, they should be talking with baseball players. They should be talking with basketball players, with hockey players, and they should have analysts coming in, and they just don't do it. And I don't know, I was really saddened. Like, I wasn't sad. I was having a great time last night. But I was kind of sad that, like, okay, on one TV, they have the NCAA final, Syracuse and North Carolina. On this other TV, they had wrestling. On this one, they had wrestling. And then over here, they had the Sounders. Well, no, put all the sports up there and ESPN, they got to get
a
new program management on this.
Well, you're saying is, I understand they didn't win the contract to air the actual games. That makes sense to me. You can't air the games, you don't have the rights to it. Understood. You can air the post game coverage. You can cover other things during the game. I understand you've got to go move on to other things or whatever. But as soon as it's over, come back, cycle back, and go. Okay, well here's the recap, and here's the great information, and here's what happened, and let's talk with the coach, and let's talk with this star player and this star player, and you know what do they think, and how are they looking to the next game? That's how you do it. That's how you roll with it. You know, but I mean, I understand you're not going to be able to cover every single game as far as airing it. But for big Final Four, I mean, this is a big deal.
This is important.
People look forward to this every year.
Yeah.
They set their calendars to it, you know? They do the brackets. The president has a bracket, and we have to hear about that. I mean, you know.
I'm surprised the NCAA hasn't banned the president then. Oh, well. Anyway, that's it for our show today. We are SSU Live, the Seattle Sports Union. With us was Matt Page. Behind the camera is Bob Lucky, and I was your host, Abraham Deweese. We'll see you guys next week on Sunday night.